down here practicing early this morning, and so they put effort into that, and it's a good job, And if you got your Bible, we're going to start off looking at John chapter 1 this morning, and this is really the fourth week in a row we've talked about this. Who is Jesus is basically the idea. Who is Jesus to you? And this is kind of the grand finale, okay? And so Jennifer actually asked me last Sunday, she said, why was church over so soon? So, you know, I always hear about it if we go late. We were actually out early last week. So she brought that to my attention. Nobody else asked me, why were we out so early? But she did, okay? So everybody else always, why were we there so late? But no, we were out early, so we're going to have to make up for that, right? Now this is some good stuff. We're going to talk about who Jesus is. We're going to look at some of the most important passages in the Bible that really explain who Jesus is, who he was, who he is, and what he did. Now, you might think I already know all that, but I'm sure you do know a lot of this, and you've heard a lot of this. But one thing we do in church is we repeat ourselves often. But, you know, I was thinking about it. We can all gain a deeper appreciation for what the Lord has done for us. Okay, that's what we want to do, is think about it, gain a deeper appreciation. I thought of a very quick example. I have a friend named Ron who is at Victory Home. Ron's been out here to church. Some of y'all might know him or know of him. But when I graduated from school last week, Ron called me and he said that he wanted to give me a gift. And so he sent up there to Wake Forest where I was graduating from a $70 gift card to Olive Garden and wanted me to go out and meet with Jennifer. Well, I appreciated that. It was awesome. And you know what? I already like Ron. We're already friends. But I like Ron a little better now. Okay? I think a little better of him. I'll tell you another story. Y'all know we've been having prowlers. Prowlers around the church. Last night we pulled up. We've been gone all day. We pulled up up to the house, and there's a car under the parking lot. Under the carport. And the back opened, and I stopped the car, and I told Jennifer, I said, we're going to have to call the police again. It turned out it was Linda and Travis bringing us a ham and some food. And so I appreciate that, okay? And so I already like them. They're already my friends, but I appreciate them even more. You can gain a greater appreciation for somebody, right? There are degrees to which we can be thankful for what the Lord's done for us. See, everybody in here might say, well, I'm thankful that Jesus died for me. You can gain a greater appreciation for that. So what I'm saying is this morning, you don't have to sit there and say, I already know that. I've already heard that. You can gain a greater appreciation for it. So hopefully that'll happen this morning. We're going to read, starting tonight, today, in John 1, we're going to read the first three verses in verse 14. Okay? So John 1, verse number 1. We'll stand up while we read these verses, if y'all don't mind. We'll stand together just for these first few verses. This is what the Bible says. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him. And without Him, nothing was made that was made. And then verse 14, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory. The glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. You can be seated. So these verses are famous because they explain who Jesus is and what He did for us. And it starts off, verse 14, it talks about the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So the Word is a title for the Lord Jesus Christ, for King Jesus. It's what He's called in the Bible sometimes. The Word, because He really came and spoke the message of God. He was the faithful witness. But He's called the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's what Christmas is all about. God became a man and dwelt among us. But these first three verses describe who Jesus was and who He is. And it says, in the beginning was the Word. Okay? In the very beginning. The Bible opens up with these words, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. But in the beginning was the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? He was in the beginning with God. And that's what it says. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. See, the Son has always existed with the Father, okay? He is in the beginning with God. And this is what's mind-blowing right here. This is what it says. I want you to listen to this, and you'll become a good theologian if you understand this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, okay? Jesus was with God in the beginning, and Jesus was God in the beginning, okay? That's what the Bible says, plain as day. There's no debating this. He was, and the next verse says, He was in the beginning with God. So who is Jesus? And then the next verse says, and all things were made through Him. Without Him, nothing was made that was made. One answer that I like to think about when I think about who is Jesus, He is God, the eternal creator. Okay? That's what the Bible says about Him. Now, it's kind of hard to understand that, wrap your mind around the fact that He was in the beginning with God, and He was God, okay? But that's what the Bible plainly says, so that's what we as Christians believe about Jesus. And then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that's what Christmas is about, that God, who was in the beginning, who created all things, became a man and dwelt among us. So that's who Jesus was, and that's what He did. Now, I have trying to teach this before and explain to people, well, this is something that Christians believe about the Trinity. You got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay? All three are separate individuals. All three are God. And there is one God. It's a little tricky. Okay? But I have used this illustration before, and I think it helps us to kind of just at least think about it, about the Trinity and about who God is, about who Jesus was. So I'll use this illustration again this morning, and maybe it'll help you, maybe it won't help you. But we'll try. I think it will. Okay? So how many Mountain Dews is that right there? We got one Mountain Dew on. One. Okay? Now I can take this Mountain Dew and open it. And I watch, y'all should figure out what I'm going to do here. Alright. So we're going to put this Mountain Dew. Try to do it kind of even. Alright. Now, how many Mountain Dews do we have now?
Two.
It's a little tricky. Somebody said, how many Mountain Dews do we have? It's still the one Mountain Dew. It's one Mountain Dew.
It's one Mountain Dew.
It's one Mountain Dew in three cups. Okay. Now, it's the exact same. Each cup is identical. Okay? Existing in three beings. Okay? So when we say that God is one, but that the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are all three God, that's what the Bible teaches. Okay? Now maybe that helps you think about it, maybe it doesn't. But what happened in the Bible, this is very clear. Jesus was with God in the beginning. He was with the Father in the beginning. He was God in the beginning. All things were made through Him. Without Him, nothing was made that was made. He was there. He was the architect behind the creation. But the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So we can think about it like that. When Jesus came to the earth, He came to the earth not revealing Himself as God in the truest sense. Right? You would look at Him, you would know He was God all the time. I mean, it was not clear. He was born in a stable, in a manger. This is what's really mind-blowing about this. When you think about Jesus and who He was on this earth, Jesus was in His early 30s. He was born as a child. He was born in a manger. Okay? He was in His early 30s. Jesus lived in a poor family, in a poor neighborhood. He was the oldest of at least seven kids. He became a carpenter and worked with his hands. At times, Jesus was homeless on this earth. Okay, very difficult life. But you know what the fact of the matter is, what the Bible would say about Him? He was God. It was hard to believe that. It was hard to believe what He said before Abraham was, I am. He was the eternal creator of all things. He was God in the flesh. But that's what we believe about the Lord Jesus Christ. That He was, and see, this is why this is such an amazing story. The Christmas story is a ridiculous story. It is a crazy story that God became a man. And see, what the Bible says, one of my favorite verses, especially at Christmas time, to talk about 2 Corinthians 8:9, it says, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became poor, that you through His poverty might become rich. See, what Jesus was, became flesh and dwelt among us. Not only did he become flesh, he became poor. He was despised. He was rejected. He lived a very difficult life. He moved often as a child. He had to move to different countries to flee from people who were trying to kill him. And then he lived a sinless life. Then he was executed on the cross. It's hard to believe this. This is what we as Christians believe. That God, the Lord Jesus Christ, it's hard to say, it's hard to look at somebody in their early 30s who was in a situation and say, that's God, that he's God. It's even harder to look at the cross and say, that's God. But it is. That's what we believe as Christians, that Jesus was God in the flesh, that he died for my sins on the cross. Because of him, I'm forgiven. And he was rich, but he became poor for me. The whole Christmas story is about what he did for me. Now, what we're going to do here is just read some other key passages about Jesus. And what I want you to do this morning is just to hear repetitively who he is, what he did. Who he is, what he did. And hopefully you'll just gain a deeper appreciation for it. Okay? So we're going to turn over to Philippians 2. And these passages might be familiar to you, they might not be. It doesn't really, they can have an effect either way. Okay? So we're going to read in Philippians 2, starting in verse number 5. And it's going to talk about Jesus. It's going to talk about who he really is, what he did. And it's not complicated. I mean, it's not something that has to be, that we can understand it and believe it, and it can make a difference in our lives. So we'll start in Philippians 2, verse 5. The Bible says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross." So see right there in verse 6, it says this, talking about Jesus. He was in the form of God. In other words, he was God. In his form, in his substance, that's who he was in the beginning. He was in the form of God, okay? And he did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. In other words, Jesus could say, "I and the Father are one." It was not robbery. It was not wrong for him to say, "I'm equal with God. I'm right there. We are equal." And it was not identity theft for him to claim to be God, okay? That's who he was. It was not robbery. But listen to what he did. It says this, verse 7, "But he made himself of no reputation." He made himself of no reputation. Talk about going undercover and not bragging about who you are. He made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant. The Bible says that he did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. See, you think about this. If a president or somebody that's popular ever goes out and works in a homeless shelter on Thanksgiving or Christmas or whatever, they got a picture of it, you know, you'll see him out there serving food to somebody or doing something. That's not what Jesus did. He made himself of no reputation. He did not, he humbled himself, and he took on the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men and being found in appearance as a man. He appeared to be a man. He did not appear to be God to the naked eye. His brothers and sisters, his own mother and father, Mary was kind of confused by what was going on, but they did not even clearly understand who he was. But what did he come to do? Listen to what it says. He humbled himself. That means he demoted himself. He moved himself way down the totem pole, and listen to what it says, and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. To say he went from the very top to the very bottom is exactly what happened. Instead of being the king who was the creator of all things, who existed with God, and who had glory, he told in John 17, he said that he had glory with God in the beginning before the worlds were ever created. But what did he do? He humbled himself, became a man, and went all the way down. How far would he go? How much would he humble himself? All the way to the point of death, even the death of the cross. The death on the cross is as low as you could possibly go, where they would strip him, they would beat him, they would pluck his beard out, they would strike him in the head. It's really unbelievable, right? What happened here. This was the eternal creator of all things, God. They would strip him, beat him, pluck his beard out, slap him, beat him with a cat of nine tails, put a crown of thorns on him, spit in his face, and then put nails in his hands and his feet and mock him, and he would die on the cross. I talked to a Muslim one time when we were down on a youth trip, and Cindy might have been there, I don't know, but there was sat across from my hotel, gas station. Our hotel was across from a gas station. And I go over there, and this Muslim guy was in the gas station every day, so I got to talk to him because we're there on this youth retreat, whatever. And he was very adamant that he would never accept the fact that God, that was God on the cross. That was a mind-blowing thing to him. And I appreciate him because he understood at least what we're saying. We're saying that Jesus was God in the flesh, and he died on the cross. And you know what Paul said? You know how Paul, well, I'm going to read you another verse. We'll go over it. If you're following along with me, from Philippians, we'll go to Colossians. It's one book over. Read another passage about Jesus. And it just is going to magnify who he is and what he's done for us. Colossians 1, verse 15. This is what it says. He's talking about Jesus. You'll see that very clearly. He is the image of the invisible God. That is a lot to say about that. Obviously, we do not have time to talk about all these verses. But he is the image of the... How do we know what God is like? If somebody asks you, what is God like? What is the best way to know what God is like? You look at the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus told his own disciples, they said, we want to see God the Father. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen God. I am the image of the invisible God. No man's ever seen God the Father who exists in heaven, but Jesus is the image of the invisible God. He is God. If you've seen one, you've seen the other one. They're identical. They are the exact same thing. He's the image of the invisible God. Listen, we'll read through this. This is a mouthful. We don't have time, but we're just going to read through it. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist. Okay, what that's saying is, he is the creator of all things, he is before all things, he is over all things, he is the king of all things. We'll skip down to verse 19, and it says this. For it pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell. See, in the Lord Jesus Christ, the fullness of God dwelt there. He was fully God. In chapter 2, verse 9, it says, for in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In other words, in a body, God dwelt in the flesh. He was in the flesh, yet he was fully God. That's what Christians believe. In the flesh, fully God. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. So listen to what it says. We'll read verse 19 and 20. For it pleased the Father that in him all the fullness should dwell, and by him to reconcile all things to himself. By him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. That right there is the story. He was the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He's above all things. He's over all things. All things were created by him. In him dwelt the fullness of God in the flesh. But it pleased God that through the Lord Jesus Christ, he would reconcile all things to himself. That means he would make peace. How can there be peace between God and man? It's through the Lord Jesus Christ. You know what it's through? It says it very clearly. Through him having made peace through the blood of his cross. That's what this is all about. It's about Jesus came to this cross and his blood was shed. His blood was poured out for the forgiveness of our sins. The Bible says without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. You cannot just ask God to forgive you and he forgives you. If that's all it took, then Jesus would not have died on the cross, okay? You can't just say, God, forgive me. And God says, okay, I forgive you because I'm really nice and I really love you. No, there had to be a death on our behalf. And what this is... God loved us so much that he sent his son, who was with him in the beginning, who was God, and he went right here and his blood was shed for us. It's an unbelievable story. And so this is what Paul would say about it. 2 Corinthians 9:15, Paul said this, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. It's a gift. This is something that God did for us. Just like I go back and I think about Ron. Okay, Ron, this is what he did for me. He called Olive Garden and paid $70 gift card for me. I appreciated that. I really did. I was shopping this morning about a great gift I've got, and I thought about that gift. A great gift. I mean, you say, well, that's not even much. Well, you do it for me. If you think that's nothing, you buy me a gift card. That'd be good. It made a difference, though. It changed the way I thought about it. I already liked it, But I have a deeper, I'm telling you, a deeper appreciation. Well, it has to have an effect on us to say, you know what? God created me and God gave me life. And yeah, you know, and a lot of people would say, you know, I believe in God. I believe that God made everything. That's good. It's very good to believe that. The Bible says you went there's one God, good. That's good. But the devils believe that in trouble. So it's good that you believe that. But what you have to do is gain a greater appreciation for God by understanding the Christmas story, really understanding what happened here, hearing it and believing it and understanding that it was the blood that was shed on that cross that reconciled me to God. It's just like we say in the divorce that occurs. There were irreconcilable differences. That's a big phrase if I use it. You got divorced. What that means is we cannot get along. We could not make up. We could not bring peace between us. We were irreconcilable. Well, I'll say this, and everybody needs to understand this. There are irreconcilable differences between you and God as you stand based on your life. God does not accept you as you are. You are a sinner, and the Bible says our sins have separated us from God. Isaiah 59:2. Your sin separates you from God. There's only one reason it's not irreconcilable. Because God reconciled us to himself by the blood that was shed on the cross. Because Jesus died for Ben Huff right there. God accepted that. That's why my sins are forgiven. Amen? That's an indescribable gift right there. Because what it really means, we get down to it, and this is what I believe, this is what the Bible teaches. I'm going to go to heaven instead of hell because of that. That's what it gets down to. I'm accepted by God. I'm a child of God. My sins have been forgiven because of the Christmas story. That's what it's all about. Turn over. I'll read a couple more passages. Hebrews chapter 1. It's a great passage. It talks about Jesus, who he is, what he did. Hebrews 1. It's just good stuff right here. It makes it pretty clear in my mind. Hebrews 1, verse number 1. It says this. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become so much better than the angels, as he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. See, it's talking about Jesus. So what it's saying is, in the past, God spoke a lot of different ways. In the Old Testament, God spoke to people a lot of different ways. But in his last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things. That means that Jesus, one day, will be the King of kings, Lord of lords, rule and reign over everything like he's supposed to. He will inherit all things. And it goes on and it says that through the worlds were created through the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the express image of God. That means he's the exact same image. He is the image of the invisible God. He upholds all things by the word of his power. The Lord Jesus Christ upholds all things. He holds all things together. See, he is God. He's not just a man. He upholds all things by the power of his word. And it says this about it, though. When he had by himself purged our sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. The Lord Jesus Christ by himself purged our sins. What does it mean to purge something? It means to cleanse it. It means to make it clean. He purged our sins. By himself, he did that. And that's what we as Christians believe, that though he was rich, for our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might become rich. See, because of what Jesus did, my sins have been forgiven. I've been adopted in the family of God, and I have an inheritance in the kingdom of God because of what he did. So what Ron did for me, $70 to Olive Garden, it does not even compare, right? But y'all agree with that? That did not even compare. But that had an impact on me. How much more should this impact our lives to understand what Jesus did for us? I'll read you one passage out of Revelation chapter 1. And I like this as good as any passage in the Bible, honestly. And you can just listen or you can follow along. Revelation 1, starting in verse number 5. It says, "And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth. To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. She's talking about Jesus, and it says, you know what? He's the faithful witness. That means that Jesus came and he taught a lot of things. And that's what's in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. You can read what Jesus said. He came and spoke the truth. But it also says he's the firstborn from the dead. That means that no man had ever been raised from the dead, but the Lord Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. He was the first one. He is the ruler over the kings of the earth. This just talks in my head. I don't know if this makes any sense to anybody at all. He's the ruler over the kings of the earth. What does that mean about him? It means he's the number one. Bible says in Colossians 1, in all things he has preeminence. He's at the top. Donald Trump would never let somebody slap him in the face. Barack Obama wouldn't either. George W. wouldn't either. They're not going to accept that. Right? It would never happen. Never. Never would they allow somebody, especially when they're in power. There is no comparison. There is no story that has ever been, even there's no make-believe story that's ever been told like that. But what it says is, to him who has loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. That is about as descriptive as you can get of what Jesus has done for us. He has loved us. That is the good news right there. You know what? And you know what makes the story even more unbelievable? Ron gave me $70 to go to Olive Garden. Okay? Me and Ron are already friends. The difference in what Jesus did, the Bible said that God demonstrated his love for us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. You know what that means? You weren't even on good terms with him. But he loved you anyway. The good news is this, it doesn't matter. I don't know how everybody in here is living. I don't know what you're doing, what you've done in the past. You might feel awful about things. You might not care about how you've lived. But the good news is God loves you anyway. He has loved us. And what he did is he washed us from our sins in his own blood. So we have the sin problem there. It's the same idea, the sin problem. But I could pick on anybody in here, we could talk about this. Miss Agnes, Pete, Nikki, sin. Ben, sin. Nathan, Chris. Everybody in here has sin in your life, in your heart, on your record, in your past. Sin. But the good news is this. He washed us from our sins in his own blood. You know what that means? The sin has been removed. The sin has been washed away. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And it required the blood sacrifice that he made for us to wash away those sins. And what that means is the fact that my sins have been washed away means when I stand before God, this is the whole good news right here. When I stand before God, God is not going to see any sin on my record. That's why he's going to say, enter into the joy of the Lord. I'm not going to be punished. I'm not going to go to hell when I stand before God. Why am I not going to be punished? Why am I not going to? Because my sins have been washed away in the blood that Christ shed for me. That's the good news of the whole Bible. Again, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Nobody's, you know what? There's people who have done a lot for us in our life. You might think somebody who's gave you a really good gift, somebody's done a lot for you. There is no comparison, though. I keep going back to this. There's no comparison compared to what the Lord Jesus Christ did for you, who is God. And what I hope this morning, I hope you gain a deeper appreciation for it. I just hope it makes you say, thank you, Lord. I hope you sit here today and you say, you know what, this is unbelievable, and I'm thankful, and you would say, express gratitude to the Lord. I thought of that song. I was going to have us sing it this morning, but we ended up not doing it, but 10,000 reasons, or bless the Lord, oh my soul. You want me to sing it? I told Lisa this morning, Tucker sings just like me. You know what Tucker is? She said, yeah, he's got a lot of volume. That's good volume there, buddy. That's good volume on that. Okay, he's got good volume. So I got good volume too, maybe. But that's all I can say. But that song says, this is what the song says in the chorus. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You want to say, sing like never before. I mean, sing it from your heart, right? Have a deep. deeper appreciation. So you come in here this morning, you say, I already believe in what you're telling me, preacher. I don't doubt that most people in here believe that. Now, there might be somebody here who's never really believed in your heart, never really understood that, hey, I'm a sinner, and God loved me, and Jesus became a man. Jesus was God at the beginning. He became a man. He died, and that blood that he shed cleansed me from my sins. What do I do to be saved? You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you'll be saved. You trust in Christ. You call upon the name of the Lord. God, forgive me. You'll be saved by grace, by trusting in Christ. That's the good news. But then hopefully this morning, we can look at this and say, I can gain a deeper appreciation. I can still think on this and reflect on this and say, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. So I'm going to close here. I'm going to turn over here to one more passage, Revelation 5. I'm just going to read this. And we read this a few weeks ago, actually. Talking about how what our response should be to God. And really what we're talking about, we read this on Thanksgiving. With Thanksgiving, we're talking about being thankful is not enough. Thank you is not enough. Really, it's supposed to affect our life, and my life is supposed to change. And I'm supposed to love God, and I'm supposed to obey God, and I'm supposed to honor the Lord. And I'm supposed to use my life to bring glory to God. And we'll read all that right here. It's Revelation 5, starting in verse 11. And this is kind of, it's not long. It's just, you have to pay attention for a second. Revelation 5:11, it says, Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. It's a vision into heaven is what this is. And they were saying with a loud voice, their volume was good, they're saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor, and glory, and blessing. You know what they're saying? The Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, should receive from us glory, and honor, and blessing, and thanksgiving. And listen, it goes on. And every creature which is in heaven, on the earth, and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, I heard saying, Blessing, and honor, and glory, and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. The 24 elders fell down and worshiped him who lives forever and ever. See, what that all means is, I'm trying to summarize it, it means that we should worship. We should be bowing before. We should be using our life to express gratitude to God and to the Father and to the Son for what they have done for us. And, you know, in church, when we come here, that's one thing we want to do, right? It's a shame to come in here. Yeah, I mean, it would be a shame to do this. Just come in here, sit here, listen to Ben talk. You sit there. You never respond to God. You never say thank you. You never worship. You never have any interaction with God, right? Hopefully you don't come here just to say, hey, good to see you this week. Good to see you. Good to see you. Glad you're here. It is about us having interaction with God. That's what this is, a place to worship the Lord, a place to express gratitude to God. It's not just to sit here and endure this and go back to the house. And so today I want to encourage you to respond to the Lord. The least we can do is say thank you. I mean, that's just scratching the surface. But you know what? When I read that passage in Philippians 2, I didn't actually read all of it, but I'm going to go back and read it all. And this is what it says. Who being in the form of God and not considered robbery but equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death to the cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and of those under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You know what I'm saying? Man, the Lord Jesus Christ is the one who is to be worshipped. Right? You know what it says? Literally, you know what it says? Every knee should bow. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And you know what? Sometimes we're more quick to say, oh, I believe in Jesus. Now, I don't doubt that. But we should bow our knee also. What does that mean to bow your knee before somebody? If I get down on my knees before somebody, what it means is I submit to that person. I recognize who that person is, and I honor that person, and I'm going to serve that person. I recognize their authority over me. Over me. I'm not equal. And so what we should do, we should be people who do bow our knee before God. And I'm not just telling you to come up here to altar call time, but I'm telling you, you need to respond to what God has done for you through Christ. And it's not just something that we sit there and say, I believe that. I believe that. I believe that. It evokes a real response from us that actually affects the way we live our life day by day. And some of you, honestly, there's a lot of people in this room who I know for a fact, they're living differently because they believe what we've talked about this morning. It has affected their life. They are trying to honor and glorify God every day in every way they possibly can. Now, nobody in this room is perfect, but there are people who have taken this to heart, and it's affecting their life. Other people, probably in this room, who this really is not making too big a difference. It's something that you would say you believe, but it's really not making too big a difference. And I'll close with one more thought right here, and this is a good way to close this. We've been talking about this for 4 weeks. Who is Jesus? When Jesus was raised from the dead, one of his disciples, whose name was Thomas, he didn't believe he was raised from the dead, that he saw Jesus after he'd been raised from the dead, and he touched the wound in his side, the scars in his hand. You know what Thomas said? My Lord and my God. You know what? That's who the Lord Jesus Christ is supposed to be for us. He's my Lord. He's my God. That means that he is the center. He is the king over me. He is the king who I serve. Is Jesus your Lord and your God? It's very possible that something else is the God of your life. Very possible that you're the God of your life, that you live for yourself. 2 Corinthians 5:15 says that you should no longer live for yourself. You should live for the one who died for you and rose again. You should live for Jesus. That's what you should do with your life. That is a daily, it is a yearly, it is a continual effort to say, I'm not going to live for me anymore. My life's not all about being Huff. I'm going to live for Jesus. And hopefully you've reached that point. If you haven't, what you do is you say, Lord, I know I am a sinner. I know that Jesus died for me. I believe that. Please forgive me. Help me to live a new life for you. And in every part that's here this morning, I hope that we just have a deeper appreciation. I hope we understand, and I hope we love the Lord, and I hope we strive to worship God, to be thankful to God, and to live our life in a way that brings honor and glory to the Lord. He is worthy. He is worthy to receive honor, praise, glory, and thanksgiving. I'm going to ask Miss Lisa to come up and play for us. And I encourage you to respond, Lord. You can kneel where you are. You can pray while you're standing up. You can come to this altar and pray. But I just think before we go home, we don't want to just listen to walk straight out the door. We want a chance to respond to the Lord. And in heaven, you know what? They don't sing complicated songs. It's not something you have to have this grand, you know. All you need to do is just a simple response to God. And you talk to the Lord. You express gratitude. You ask for forgiveness if you feel like that's what you need to do. But we'll have a time of response to the Lord. You can come to the altar and pray. If you'd like for me to pray for you, pray with you, I will do that. You can pray where you are. But I hope that when we just think about all this morning, hopefully it has some effect in our mind and heart. So I ask everybody who will stand up.